Factors that improve the yield of crop plants. Changing maturity time. By growing a plant that grows and yields faster, the crop cycle is reduced to increase profits. This reduces the cost that a farmer incurs during crop production. Uniform maturity allows the farmer to harvest crops together. Other agronomical factors. Tall branching plants are beneficial for plants whose leaves are to be utilized. For example, fodder crops that are grown to feed farm animals. Short plants are beneficial in cereals so that nutrition is not consumed by the plant to grow taller.
Correct. Thank you. So basically, you know, there are much many more factors. One very important factor which they are trying out now is by changing the maturity time. Right? So how do you change the maturity time? For example, normally which what many farmers they do is that they plant crops in batches in one field only, in one farm only, but they plant it in batches. Why? Could be, you know, positive manpower. It's just him and his, you know, another person or maybe his wife, you know, just two of them. So it will be difficult for them to manage an entire field. So they do plot wise and they just grow it in batches. But what happens is that, you know, by the time, you know, this grows, it's just, this is just 15 day old and this is about to be sown. Right? So first they need to harvest this. After 1 month, they'll harvest this. And after 2 months, they'll harvest this. So what happened? It is actually, you know, if not triple, but their cost has gone up. Right? Just imagine if they could, you know, sow all of them at one go. Right? Then at least, you know, the chemicals, the weeds, weedicides, the pesticide that they would have needed all would have also been less. Because they could have sprayed the entire field. Right? So basically the crux of the matter is instead of growing it in batches, they should have it, you know, maturity time should be at the same time. Because, you know, on that labor cost, you know, depends a lot. So that it can be harvested all of them together. They can harvest all of them together. Right? And what are the other agronomical factors? This is what we discussed. You know, the tall branching plants. Right, this takes time to grow because it will grow tall, it will have branches, but these are beneficial because the leaves can be fed to the farm animals. Right, so this is a beneficial thing. Vis-a-vis short plant, they would rather have prefer cereals to have be short. Why? Because if they grow taller, they would eat away or they would consume many manure or many fertilizers from the ground and just taking up or picking up height. But I don't need the height. I just need the cereals. So I will not allow it to grow. I would prefer it to be short, but to have more, you know, fruits in it. Right? Otherwise, half of the nutrients will be consumed only to pick up height and to have leaves. Okay. Last, Srishti, read this out.
Yes, ma'am. Crop production management. Crop production management includes practices which help in lowering of soil erosion, provide better facilities to maximize utilization of nutrients, improve the fertility of soil, enhancing crop production.
Yeah, so this is basically an overall of what we actually discussed. It covers everything, right? From seed selection to soil management to irrigation, to pest control, you know, to take genetically modified seeds, to everything, storage and everything. It covers everything. Production management, right? So now we come to the nutrient management. Okay. Arnav, your time again, you'll have to read it out.
Like other living organisms, plants also require nutrients for building their structure and maintaining their body functions. The plants require inorganic elements, which they chiefly obtain from the soil, where these elements occur in the form of minerals. Besides soil, the nutrients are also supplied to plants by air and water. The major elements supplied by air are carbon and oxygen. Soil is the main source to supply rest of essential elements to the plants.
Correct. So basically, you know, here they're laying a lot of emphasis on the nutrient part. Obviously, everything boils down to nutrient and water, you know. So when we talk about nutrient, it's basically, you know, how much nutrient is the soil, how much nutritious is the soil, right? Has the soil been prepared adequately? Has adequate manure, fertilizer, green fertilizer, everything? Is it in a balance? It cannot be a blanket thing for all the kind of soil, but it has to be crop dependent, right? If it is a leguminous plant, then you have to supply good amount of nitrogen. If it is a plant that you have sown for having flowers and fruits, then you need to give again, you know, good amount of nitrogen. NPK, nitrogen, phosphorus and potassium, right? So we have to, it's a continuous thing. It's like just like the way we have food 4 times in a day. The plants also need a lot of food, and their food is nutrient. Only then will they be healthy and their production would be good, right? So the plant requires inorganic elements, which they chiefly obtain from the soil, where these elements occur in the form of minerals, right? So basically, they could already be in the soil, or the farmer could provide them in the form of manure, fertilizer, green manure and other things. Besides soil, the nutrients are also supplied to plants by air and water, right? The kind of water that the farmer uses for irrigating his field, that is also very important. You know, he needs to see whether he is using wastewater or he's using a water good enough to provide nutrition, or is he using a water which is highly acidic, right? Then that would be really detrimental for the crops and the soil. So nutrients also come from air, as in water, and of course from air in the form of carbon and oxygen, right? So soil, water and air, all three of them provide nutrients to the plants, correct? This is what I was discussing, manures. Okay, what is the difference between manure and fertilizer? Who can tell me? Bhumika, you can type in if you know the answer.
Ma'am, for example, like fertilizers, as you told, NPK fertilizers, and in manures, cow dung is used. The vegetable wastes can be also used by dumping it in a pit, and by decomposition by the microbes, so that it can be used to maximize the life of the plants.
Okay, so basically manures are all naturally made, right? They could be like animal waste, they could be green manure, like there are a few plants which can be grown before, right? They could be plant waste, they could be vermicompost, right? They could be just normal compost, so they could be of all types, correct? Now, Bhumika is just left, okay. So basically, you know, manures have very high amounts of, first and foremost, you know, actually nitrogen. You know, it has a lot of organic matter. It has a lot of ammonia in it, nitrates. It has got a lot of zinc, magnesium, copper, right, manganese and sodium. So it is actually very rich. The only problem with manure is that you don't know the quantity. Right, unlike a fertilizer, which is very, you know, it has got 10% nitrogen, it has got 55% potassium, you know the amount because it's been made in that way. It is made to order. But with a manure, you don't know how much of plant waste is there, what is the kind of animal waste, you know, whether there are any rotten things into it or not. So this is not measurable. That's the only problem with manure. But overall, they are very good. They're very rich in nutrients.
Yes, ma'am. The advantages of manure enriches the soil with nutrients. Manure adds organic matter called humus to the soil, which restores the soil texture for better retention of water and aeration of soil. The organic matter in manure provides food for the soil organisms, decomposes, such as bacteria, fungi, etc. will help provide nutrients to the plant. Disadvantages of manure. Manures are bulky with low nutrition content. The nutrients get released slowly, unable to fulfill high and rapid demands of nutrients required by improved high yielding hybrid varieties of crops.
Correct. So basically the thing is that it is much more advantageous than, you know, it is much more helpful than fertilizers, right? It has got, as I said, a lot of organic matter in it, humus, you know, which, you know, it actually restores the soil texture, all the nutrients that it lost, the soil lost during its previous cultivation, you know, it will all regain back in a very natural and in a very normal way, right? And, you know, it manures, as we know, you know, has got a, it's not, it's very porous. So it gives a lot of, provides a lot of aeration to the soil, right? The soil also requires a lot of oxygen. The more the oxygen that it has, it is good for it, right? It can provide aeration, right? And organic matter in manures provide food for the soil organisms. So there would be a lot of helminths. There would be a lot of, you know, worms and microbes in the soil. That would also, the microbes would also get their food from the manure, so they would also grow in a very healthy manner. Yeah, that's a different thing that we need to find out, whether those microbes are helpful microbes or harmful. We have to encourage in the growth of the helpful microbes. Okay, now what are the disadvantages of manure? The disadvantages are, of course, they are very bulky. You know, it's not very easy to handle them. Most of them are moist. They have a lot of water content in it, right? With low nutrient content as in you have to spray a lot of manure to get maybe, you know, 20 grams of certain element. Vis-a-vis fertilizer, you just spray 50 grams, you will get 10 grams of that. So basically you have to, the quantity used is very high in manure, right? Nutrients get released slowly and they are unable to fulfill the high and rapid demands of nutrients. So basically, that's what I was saying, that you really could not quantify that what is the amount of manganese that's there in a manure. And it would take its own sweet time to be released and to be absorbed by the soil and then being broken up and then being utilized. It's a very time-taking and a tedious thing, but it is not harmful. The types of manure are farmyard manure, right, which is very easily available in the villages. It could be, you know, a mixture of animal waste, as in the cattle excreta, urine of cattle, litter, roughage, whatever, you know. Nothing is to be wasted or thrown, so they all use it as a farmyard manure. What is compost? Compost is basically, you know, a biological process through which, you know, these are again of several types, like vermicompost is just one of them, right? Okay, Bhumika, so that's okay. I'll give you a recap at the end of it, huh? Otherwise, we'll just lose the flow. You just carry on. Okay, so the compost, in compost, what happens is that, you know, both aerobically and anaerobically, the compost can be prepared, both in the presence and in the absence of oxygen. And what is green manuring? Green manuring is basically, you know, when turning and plowing and mixing of the green crops are done with soil to improve the physical structure and the soil fertility, right? Basically, green manuring can also be said that, you know, you grow certain kind of crops. Maybe you grow a methi, which would just take 30 days. You know, you grow it and then you sow it and you grow it, you harvest it. So it's a kind of a green manure which will add certain nutrient value to the soil so that it's ready for growing the next round.